All right, so it's time and welcome to the first interactive session of EuroPython 2021 by Mauro Pellucci. So now Mauro is a senior data scientist and a big data engineer. And Mauro seems to also have a lot of very interesting collaborations with the University of Milano Bicocca. I don't know whether I pronounced that correctly.
Right, you're perfect.
Oh, thank you. So I'm sure he could also tell you a lot more about the collaborations and the interesting projects he's involved with. And today he will show us data injection and big data, build a data set from zero to solid. And you can take it away, Mauro. And so if anybody at any point has any questions, you can just basically talk directly into the Zoom if you want to. And you could also text by chat into the Matrix room in Argument Clinic. So yeah, here you go, Mauro.
Okay, thank you, Raquel. Thank you for your beautiful introduction. So my name is Mauro Pellucci, not Pellucci, but it's the same because I usually work with a lot of English guys, so Pellucci is okay for me. So hello everyone, and welcome to this first interactive session of EuroPython 2021. First of all, I'd like to thank you, the EuroPython organizer. I'd like to thank you, Raquel, for her assistance today. And also thank you to everyone who will hear today with me and who will follow my presentation. So I think I will try to make this remote session less remote if possible. So only three topics. If you have any questions, please unmute and try to send me the question. It's not a problem. You can use also the Zoom chat. I am the Zoom chat on my screen. So if you want, you can put your question on the chat. And for me, it's a pleasure to try to respond to you. Of course, you can use the Matrix server to send me the question. And Raquel will assist me for each question. And of course, the material of this interactive section is already shared on my GitHub repo. So my GitHub repo is Mauro Pellucci, EuroPython 2021. I am putting the link directly in the chat. So you have the link in the chat. Please, Raquel, can you share also the link in the Matrix server? So if some attendees will come later, they will have the link. So let me to speak about this interactive section. This interactive section is about data ingestion and big data. So what we will try to do in 1 hour, and we will try to build a data set with web scraping. You know, the scope of web scraping is to create a data set. So when I speak about data set, I'm speaking about rows and columns, because the result of a scraping activity is not a data lake, is not a sort of abstracted data, but the scope of the session today is try to build something structured. So it's like, let me to use this uncommon term, it's like an Excel file. So we will try to produce a data set with rows and columns. Of course, in some of these columns, we will store something very structured, like image and text. But the goal today is to start from a website, try to scrape the data and build a data set. We will use, of course, Python code. We are at EuroPython. We will use Google Colab, so it's only an exercise. But in this case, Google Colab is very useful to try to make this interactive session more interactive. Of course, you can reuse my code for your purpose. Okay, I don't know if you want to create a data set, if you want to reproduce yourself this exercise is good for me, it's not a problem. And you can use Google Colab, of course, but you can also move the notebook on your local environment. It's not a problem. In the notebook, you will find some topic to move the notebook from Google Colab to Jupyter Notebook, Jupyter Lab, I don't know, where you want them. Of course, when we speak about big data, you have to have in mind the 3V about big data, because I have an experience of 20 years in data, and I think I am working with big data since 2010, so for the last 10 years. But usually when we have in mind big data, the focus is on the volume, on the variety, and on the velocity. So the volume, because we have big data, we have a lot of data. We have velocity because we can collect this data, and this data are generated with are generated faster. I don't know, you have in mind IoT system, smartphone, and so on. And the variety, because in the web, you know, we can collect images, videos, text. So the structure of the data is not by default. Of course, if we have in mind these three features of big data, we have in mind three technology features of big data, because the volume, the variety, and the velocity are technology features. But remember, guys, that when we speak about big data, we have also other features. In my mind, they are more important. We have the veracity, because when we collect data from the web, we will see today that we collect a lot of noise. We don't have a clear idea of the data collected. So the scope today is only to give a look to the data ingestion. But remember, after data ingestion, there are some other mandatory step to use big data to make decision, because another important feature of big data is the value. If we are not able to produce value from big data, from the data collected from the web, our exercise is not good, because the scope is not a technology exercise, it's not to collect everything. Of course, if we are able to produce a system that collects everything from the web, it's good, but we will spend a lot of money, we will spend a lot of time, but at the end of the story, we will have a lot of data, but no one will use this data. The scope of collect data from the web is to produce value for the end users. So keep in mind that after data ingestion, we will have always a phase of data processing, data pre-processing with machine learning, I don't know. Of course, we will have a phase of data processing where we will put in quality this data, and where we will prepare the data for the analysis. And at the end of the story, we will store the data inside the warehouse, because the scope of data science system is to support the end user to make decision. This is the overall data flow of a data science system. So data ingestion, data processing, data presentation, and finally, I don't know, we can use some business intelligence tools, some model, I don't know. But keep in mind, when we speak about big data, we have to remember the three traditional features: volume, variety, and velocity. But we have also the veracity and the value. So Raquel already introduced me, so I don't want to speak a lot about me. Of course, it's not the part for today, but I am an engineer and data science, so my role is quite hybrid between the two main topics of data science, so engineering and modeling. Currently, I'm working for MSC Barton Glass. MSC Barton Glass is a company who collects data from the web to produce video. Only to give you or full overview of the system, I want to show you the final result of or scraping activities, because I am the responsible, I am the main engineer of a big project for the European Union. It's a public project, and this project is called Real-Time Labor Market Information System on Skill Requirements. So I try to simplify now the question. This project is about the collection of job posting on the web. You have in mind the job posting on the web, we have a title, a description. So our scope, the scope of the European Union for this project is to try to collect every job post published in the European Union to create a warehouse to support the decision maker about the labor market. So only to share with you, this is the result, for example. This so it's the final phase, is the business intelligence tool over this data collected with web scraping. I'm sharing the link in the chat, in the Zoom chat. So this this result is called the Skills OVETE, the Skills Online Vacancy Analysis Tool for Europe. So this final result is based by Tableau. But we can also use another BI tool. I am not a fan of Tableau. So as you can see, we collect, I don't know, Raquel, we have a question in the chat about the screen, is shared correctly? Okay, thank you. Okay, so as you can see, we collect a lot of job posting in the web. We don't have the final number here, but we are collecting in the last 4 years something like 400 million job posting. Of course, we have a process to clean the data, deduplicate the data, and put in quality. And we use a lot of machine learning to try to normalize the data. To normalize the data. As you can see, I can select, for example, country. I'm starting from Italy because I am from Italy, and I can go deeper in the details. So as you can see, the result of web scraping activities is not only to collect data, but is to try to collect data, create a data set, and support the decision maker. In this case, for example, if I go to the professional, I can see that the main profession, as which, for example, to the occupation insight, the main profession required by the employers in Italy I can use select professional. I go, for example, to Italy. The system is open, so you can try to use it. I go to the ICT professional, and of course, it's fun because the most required profession in Italy, but not in Italy, you know, is the software developer. So, but remember, have in mind what is a job posting in the web. We don't have, so we can have a title, we can have a request for a job posting about software developer, but not only. A lot of time we have a Java developer, Python developer, I don't know, C Sharp developer. So the goal is not, the challenge is not at the end when we collect the data. So the scope of today, of the next 15 minutes, is to collect the data. But the complete exercise is to apply machine learning, apply some, I don't know, some system based on rule to try to normalize the data and produce value. Another nice tool produced by this system is this one, is the tool most simple than Tableau. For example, I can go deeper, I don't know, in German, and I can analyze the economic sector in German. And also this data are collected with web scraping. So let me to continue now. I don't have a question in chat, so I can continue. A small agenda for today. Of course, we will speak something about the ingestion patterns. We will see the difference between scraping and crawling. For example, for the European project that I have mentioned a couple of minutes ago, we are using scraper, but also crawler, because it's difficult to maintain 500 different scraper. So in some case we use some scraping task, in our case we use crawling task. Of course, the data produced by the two different methodology are different, and we will see the main difference between these two tools. The main part of the agenda today is to create a dataset. So the goal is to try to navigate Indiegogo. Indiegogo is a crowdfunding platform. I don't know if you know it. It's I think it's very good for scraper and for scraper exercise. And we will explain why I think it. But the main goal today is to try to navigate Indiegogo with Python and Selenium to create a dataset. And at the end, we will speak about ethics. Of course, because everything published on the web, you know, is public. So everyone can take it. So it's difficult to address the ethics challenge. Because why is difficult? Because when you publish something in the web, you don't know if someone will take it, and you don't know if someone will take it and what is the scope. So every time that you will run or scraping activities, every time you will collect data from the web, you have to keep attention to the data. Because in this case, the stuff is not about who published the data, but is on the side who collect the data. So you have to keep in mind that, to repeat yourself the question, can I collect this data? Can I collect this data for my purpose? Can I collect the data for my purpose? Or I have to inform the original owner of the data? And we will speak a little about ethics. So let me to start from the data ingestion pattern. So I already speak about this topic because, of course, the complete exercise about data ingestion is only a part of a big picture. So when we speak about a big picture, in this case, it's the overall data flow. We have, of course, to collect data from the web. But the data collected from the web are with a lot of noise, with a lot of incompleteness. The accuracy is very slow. So we have to, when we design a system based on data collected from the web, you have to keep in mind that the main tasks are data ingestion, the data processing, the data presentation, and the final, the use of the data. And during these four steps, we have always to measure the quality of the data. So the completeness, the accuracy, the presence of empty values, because the scope of the first task, the ingestion, is to collect data. The scope of data processing is to increase the quality of the data. The scope of data presentation is to store the data in the data warehouse system, and at the end, the scope of the end user is to use the data to produce video. So please keep in mind these four main topics. Of course, today the scope is to speak about data ingestion, so web scraping. So please, Raquel, can you share the first Zoom pool? I want to give this session more interactive. So
yes, I have shared.
Thank you, Raquel. Thank you, Raquel. So I want to send you a question. What is web scraping? So of course, it's only a joke. I have six responses. Of course, okay, you are right. So I don't wait a lot on this poll. It's only to try to engage you. Of course, the right answer is the B. So the scope of web scraping is to extract structured content from a web page. And of course, we will create during this session an application in Python to run all scraping activities. And there are a lot of tools. to scrape data from web tools with different programming language, different framework. There are also some already ready tools that use drag and drop, so visual tools with no programming language to produce data. Of course, the scope today is to use Python. Python is very nice and very flexible to run scripting activities, of course, but it's not only the tools. And also in Python, there are a lot of libraries. Today, the scope is to use Selenium. Selenium is not only a library for scraping. Of course, the scope of Selenium is not to scrape data from the web. The scope of Selenium is to try to run a sort of automation, so of repetitive task on a browser. So we can use Selenium to run some scraping activities because it's very nice and it's very flexible to create application in Selenium to scrape data from the web. So, of course, the first difference is about scraping and crawling. Let me to start to speak about crawling. You know, the crawling is the job of Google. Okay, I think I am not wrong if I associate the word crawler, the term crawling, the task crawling with Google, Bing, and so on, because the main task of this player, let me to close the poll. Okay, the main task of this big player is to try to collect everything from the web. And I think if you have in mind the job of Google, you have in mind the difference between crawling and scraping, because the result, the scope of a crawler is to try to store all the data. So, you know, the work, the job of the Google bot is to try to navigate the web and to store in the data lake, in a file system, every page. The scope of the scraper, the scope of scraping activity is a little different. With the scraper, of course, we collect, I don't know, the HTML code of the page, the entire text of the page, but the real scope of the scraper, the real scope of the scraping activities is to create or structure a dataset. When I speak about structured dataset, you have to have in mind an Excel file with rows and columns. Of course, in a shell, we can store a text, we can store an image, we can store a complex struct. It's not a problem with NoSQL, DBMS, with, I don't know, Parquet file, with JSON file. It's not a problem. We don't have to store Excel file, of course. But you have in mind the scope of a scraper is to try to cut and paste some portion of a web page in a dataset. So in our case, we will scrape data from Indiegogo. Indiegogo has a lot of campaigns about games, art, comics, and so on. And our final dataset will contain the title, the ID, the URL, the description, the balance, I don't know, the start date, the end date for each single campaign. So if in Indiegogo we will find 5,000 different projects, our final dataset will contain 5,000 different rows. Every row will be composed by title, description, balance, currency, start date, end date, URL, image, category, and so on. I don't know if it's clear. Can I continue? I don't know if there are some questions in the matrix. Thank you, Jasper. Jasper? Okay. Okay, so the main task when we speak about the scraping is I try to keep the focus to the first topic. So to identifying web pages and to understand the structure of a page. Because before to start to write code, to program something, we have to explore the, we have to inspect, the real term is inspect the web page structure, and to understand where the portion that we have to take is stored. So we have to understand something about HTML, we have to understand something about browser, but it's not difficult, of course, because with a simple browser like Chrome. So for the session today, I think it's better to use Chrome, because with Chrome, we have a lot of nice feature for scraping exercise. So with the browser, we can identify the portion of the page that we need. So the first task about the scraping is to try to identify this portion of the page and to try to link every portion of the web page to the final dataset, which is the main task. Because at the end of the story, the code is very easy. We will see that with 10 lines of Python, we can run the scraper. The first exercise is more complex because we have to use, I don't know, a little of creativity, a little of experience to try to identify the query to run on a web page to extract the data. But before to start to program, before to start to identify the page, please try to respond to answer to the question. Why? Why we scrape data? You can use the chat if you want, you can unmute yourself. What are the purpose of scraping data?
Maybe because you can get insights of what people are interested in.
Okay, of course, thank you. Okay, data collection, thank you, Jesper. Okay, but data collection for what? Try to imagine. Okay, I built a data set. What is the final scope? Because when we scrape data, we can collect everything. But we have to stop at the time because we can create a scraper that scrape everything from our page. So have in mind the final goal of a web scraper. For example, like Osvaldo has mentioned, we can create a scraper for research purpose. So I work in university and a lot of time someone calls me. Okay, Mauro, can you please scrape data from, I don't know, Glassdoor, from fan page, from a newspaper, because I wanted to run an academic research. So the first scope to scrape data is to try to create a data set for research purpose. I think it is one of the main scope. Second, for business purpose, of course. For example, we collect data for the European Union, but I also collect data to sell data to my stakeholder. So when I use, for example, job posting, why we use, so what is the scope for me to write job posting? Because with job posting, I can run some competitive analysis between two employers. I can measure my online reputation. I can run a product and price comparison. A lot of time, my students in university use web scraping, for example, to collect price from Amazon and compare the price on Amazon with the price of their employer, with their company. It's normal. For example, we can create some scraper to understand what the competitor doing, what, I don't know, we can use a scraper to collect data from social network. We can try to detect some fraudulent reviews, for example, because we can scrape data from every website. Everything published on the web could be taken from a web scraper. is not a problem. We can extract data from Amazon, Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, Reddit. In my 10 years of experience about web scraping, I saw a lot of different type of sources. I don't know, Yahoo Finance, a lot of newspaper, it's not a problem. Remember the ethics aspect. When you collect data, you have to repeat yourself the question. Of course, repeat myself my question. The question, can I collect this data for my purpose? Because the owner of the data don't have the vision to understand what is your purpose. So the ethics aspect in on our end. We have to repeat ourselves the question, can I collect the data for my purpose? For example, I collect data about job posting, but never in my work life, I sold the data to an employment agency with, I don't know, the URL, with the source, I don't know, because my scope is to sell aggregate set, to sell analysis about labor market. My scope is not to create Mauro Pelucci job board. It's not my scope. My scope is to collect data from the job board, to create some statistics, some analytics, some KPI about the labor market, and to sell to my stakeholder aggregate set. So I am not a competitor, for example, of LinkedIn, because my purpose is not to publish. I don't collect data, job posting, to publish, to republish job posting, because I think it's not correct. So have in mind that when you collect data, to repeat yourself the question, can I collect this stuff for my purpose? Of course, we have different tools to run scraping. We have some visual tools, like I mentioned, import.io, mozenga.com, Octopass. If I remember, octopass.com is free. So it's not completely free, but has some free features. Of course, visual tools are very, very good, but it's difficult to use visual tools with a complex website. So I don't use this type of tools. The second frameworks, for example, Natch with Solr, Natch with Elasticsearch, HTTTrack, I think one of the most famous is Stormcrawler. Usually this type of tools are crawler. So we can use Natch, for example, or Stormcrawler to collect everything from the web. It's not difficult. These tools are already ready. We have also to download the tools and use it. Of course, we can write some custom code in Java with JSOUP, in Python with Scrapy, Beautiful Soup, or Selenium. I only mentioned these four libraries in two languages, but there are a lot of different languages, of course. Beautiful Soup is different than Selenium because Selenium uses a browser. So mainly we have a Phantom browser to run the scrape. Beautiful Soup is only a parser. It's only a parser. So in Beautiful Soup, we have to put in input the HTML code of the web page, and we can run the parsing activity and run query. So let me to start. I don't know. So in this slide, you can see my repo. Let me to reshare in the chat. So if someone was in late, you have my repo in the chat. If you navigate in my repo, you find under the notebook folder, the notebook that we will use to run this exercise. So I put also the link of the notebook in the chat. So I don't know if there are questions on chat. I think no. On the Matrix server, Raquel?
No, it was just a very nice answer about why web scrape. Yeah.
Okay, so, can you share the answer?
Yes, of course. It's like, it says to access the data automatically, e.g. daily, which is not available via API for further analysis, collection and or ML, machine learning.
Ah, you are right, you are right. Perfect. Thank you, Raquel. So I go ahead to my session because this is the main part of the session. So we will start from IndigoGo. We will write some Python code to produce a file dataset. So the main tool for to start with scraping activity is the browser. So we can use, so I'd like to use Chrome. So I suggest you to use Chrome because in a Chrome or Chromium-based browser, for example, also our browser like Chrome based on Chromium has the same feature. But of course, with Chrome, we have a lot of nice tools, nice feature to inspect the website because the main part of web scraping is try to identify the portion of the page. So if we go to the IndigoGo web page, let me to move the zoom bar. So I am putting the link on the chat. So IndigoGo, you know, is a website about campaigns. So if you don't know, there is a lot of funding and campaign activity about audio, comics, tools, film, games, and so on. And our scope is to try to identify each single part, for example, the title, the description, the balance, the currency, and to create our dataset. So, sorry, I click to open the site. So, first of all, we have to start from the browser because on the browser, you know, let me to go to the main page. Okay. You know, in the browser under the option, so I cannot zoom, I'm sorry, this part because I cannot zoom the part, but under the, usually if you use Chrome, under the more tools, developer tools, we have a nice tools to try to identify the portion of the page that we need. Because I am using the elements tab in this case, and we will understand why the elements in a couple of minutes, but I have this tool, the inspect tool. Why the inspect tool? Because with the inspect tool, I can move on the page and I can identify each single part of the page. For example, if I go here and I click, so in this orange, it's a orange and green box. If I click, as you can see, in this area, I have the HTML code that use the browser to show me the box. Why the browser? Because I have the HTML code in two tabs, the elements and in the sources. In the sources, I have the HTML part, HTML code, sorry, HTML code received by the web server to my browser. In the elements, I have the HTML code refactored, reworked by the browser. So if I use Selenium, I am using a browser to run the scraping activity. So it's better to use the elements part. So Selenium is better than the other tools because with Selenium, if the website is with a lot of Ajax script and so on, everything could be taken by Selenium. So it's not a problem. As you can see, if I go here, I can identify that with the discoverable dash card, if I go to the second, I have a lot of discoverable dash card. So I there is this pattern. So with this box, if I go down, if I click, as you can see, I can identify each single part. So my goal today is to try to scrape this discoverable dash card and to run a query on it to extract the title, the description, the balance, the currency. Of course, I need a query language. Why a query language? Because I have to run query on this web page. So there is a couple of run qui of query of query framework. The first of XPath. XPath is not on purpose today because usually I use the CSS selector framework. Why CSS selector framework? Because the CSS selector framework is in CSS selector framework you can use the tag of HTML code and also the class. So it's more easy to use the design of the page to identify the portion, and it's more easy for us and is more manageable to use, for example, the class, because if a designer used the discoverable dash card tag to identify the card of the project on the page, I think it's a feature of the site. So it's more easy for us to run a query of this type. So the query in CSS selector are very easy. As you can see, the language is not complex like SQL, for example, because we have, for example, element div dot class. And if I run a query with element dot class, I can take every portion of the page with this element and this class. For example, if I go here, I am in the element part, I use the command F because I am on Mac or control F to open this find by string selector or XPath feature, and I can write my query. For example, I write the query discoverable dash card. So as you can see, I'm able to navigate the page. I found 14 different portions. In my mind, there are only 12 portions, but it's easy now to identify single portion because as you can see, if I use the expect page, I can go here in the title, and as you can see, I can identify the class. I have the class discoverable dash title. So I can run a query, for example, with div dot discoverable card dash title. I put the query in the chat. And in this case, I am finding 12 different titles. And if I go down with the title, with the arrow, I can identify each single title of the page. So the complex part of the scraping is this one. Try to identify and write the query. It's of course, IndiegoGo is very simple because it's the reason that I'm using IndiegoGo. But for example, I can try to identify, for example, the category. It's very easy because I have the class discoverable dash category. So if I run a query with discoverable card dash category, I can find each single category of the website. I put also in this case the query in the chat. So it's the complex part because to write a query is not every time very easy, like in this case. So if you are in difficult, I don't know, you can use also an app from the browser, because if you click with the right button on a portion, you have the copy menu, and under the copy menu, there is the copy selector. With the copy selector, you can have an app to write the query. For example, if I copy this one, as you can see, I have a complex CSS selector query, but at the end, if I remove the first part, I have the query that I need. Of course, in this case, I have two classes. With the syntax element.class.class, I am forcing the condition class, the first class, and the second class. So this is the main part of the exercise. Let me to identify the description, for example, in this case is discoverable card dash description. And also in this case, it's very easy to identify the description part and putting also this one in the chat. So at the end of the story, the first task about scraping is to try to write. Oh, in the slide you have everything, of course. I am navigating the site, but in the slide you will find every single part. The main task is to try to write a table with each single element and the query. For example, for the link, I have to use a discoverable dash card A. For the category, dot discoverable card dash category. For the title, and so on. Now we can move to Selenium. I don't know if there are questions, Raquel?
No.
Okay. So, because now it's very easy, because we have the queries, we have only to use Selenium to run the queries. So, I am going to Google Colab. Let me to open the notebook so you can see how to open the notebook. I am go to File, Open Notebook. You can use the link to my notebook in GitHub. If you go to the GitHub tab on Google Colab, and if you put the link, Google Colab open the page and identify the notebook, and you can click on it. Okay, so we can start. The first stuff in Google Colab, you know, Google Colab is in cloud, so it is not on our local system, so we have to install the libraries. So with pipinstall selenium and apt-get, I am installing Selenium. Okay, but anyway, install Selenium and install the browser, the Phantom browser, because Selenium will use a Phantom browser on Google Colab. Of course, you can run this notebook also on your side. It's not a problem. You have only to download the notebook and open the notebook on Jupyter, for example, and to download from this link, you have the link in the notebook, the Chrome driver relative to your version of Google Chrome. So please check the version of Google Chrome. Has to be the same version of the Chrome driver, and then you have to edit the connection as in the notebook. However, in the notebook you will find the code to run the notebook locally. So after the setup of the libraries, let me to clear this part, we can import the libraries. As you can see, I am importing Selenium, the Selenium driver, the TQDM library, and TQDM is only to have a progress bar, so it's a nice feature. It's not a functional requirement, only to make more nice my notebook. Pandas to produce final CSV files. The pretty print, also in this case, is not a functional requirement. A pretty print is to print the JSON, the dictionary created in a more nice way. So after the import, I can create the Chrome option. Why Chrome option? Because we have to give an input to the Chrome driver some parameters. For example, the headless, because I am in a cloud environment, so the Phantom browser is completely Phantom. If you run this notebook locally, you can remove this option and you will see the browser open, the click, and so on. Of course, we have to put the user agent. What is the user agent? It's the signature of your browser when your browser run a request run to the web server. So in this case, I am putting a false signature. So why? Because when I run the script, the crawling activities, the scraping activities, I have to emulate the user. So in this case, my Phantom browser we will present the signature of Chrome on a Mac. So in this case, in some case, it's better to use a real signature. So to put the user agent real. In some case, it's better to use a custom user agent. For example, you can use I am a bot and I am scraping your data. If you want, you can, I don't know, you can put whatever you want. It's not a problem. Of course, if you want to better emulate the end user, it's better to use a real signature. Now we have everything and we can instantiate our Phantom browser. In this case, it's Chrome. So webdriver.chrome, I pass the Chrome option input and the VD object is my Phantom web driver. As you can see, I don't see a browser, but if I run a get request to the page, this page is the same page that I'm using here. It's the same page. If I run a get and on the VD object, if I run the same screenshot, I can add the page. As you can see, it's better to click this OK. This is only an image. Let me to open the image. If I go here in Google Colab and I click on the image, I can see the image in this part. As you can see, my browser is OK because my Phantom browser is navigate the Indiegogo campaign. So now we can use Selenium to run our CSS query. So of course, let me to check if the title is correct because we have a lot of nice feature on the VD object. As you can see, we can add cookie, we can close the page, we can add the current URL, we can delete cookies, we can, for example, get the page source, but we have also a lot of method like find element by class name, by CSS selector, by XPath, and find elements with the same find elements by XPath, find elements by CSS selector. What is the difference between the two different methodology? Find element return one single element from your query. Find elements return a list of elements. So if your query is wrong, the find element returns an error. If your query is wrong, find elements return an empty array. So usually I use every time the find elements because with the find elements, I have an array in output and with len my array, I can check if my query is right or not right and I can make a decision if the query is right or not right, if the element is present or not present. So let me to go down a little. First of all, I want to keep each single box of the Indiegogo website. I'm using the first query, so discoverable dash card. If I run the query and if I check the result, as you can see, I am finding 12 campaigns. So it's okay, it's expected because in the first page of Indiegogo, I have 12 project. Now I can write the main part of the scraper. So as you can see, I have 20 lines of code, but more or less they are always the same. So I run a cycle, a for cycle. So for project in my list of project, my list project is the result of a previous operation. And on this project, I can run query. So the previous query stored in my notes are run on each single project, so on each single area of the Indiegogo website. So first of all, I run a query with the if condition. So If the query return at least one element, I take the first element and the text part of the element. If the query doesn't return nothing, I leave the variables equal to blank. So as you can see, with this approach, I can scrape the first page of IndiegoGo. So I am running the exercise. We can follow, so it's very faster, and we can check the result. So as you can see, I append the data to an array, and I find balance, the category productivity, euro, description, the image, the title. I think this is the first, I hope. If I go here, okay, as you can see, it's the first. We have, of course, the second, and so on. So we have built our first scraper on the first page of IndiegoGo. Now I create a function. So I put this code inside the function only to organize better my code. So the code is the same as the previous. I put in input to this function the box, the card of the project. I run the scraper and return the dictionary. And now I try to run my function on the first page. So my expectation is to find 12 campaigns. So it's very fast. It's very nice because we have also TQDM. So it's okay. Now we have to run the scrape with a lot of page because in this case we have only 12 campaigns. So mainly I can copy and paste manually. The real goal is to try to download everything. So the question is how to end the activities. I have a lot of possibility, not only one. I can run the scrape on the first 1,000 pages. And when I have as a result an error, the 404 error page, page not found error, I can stop my scraper. I can try to understand how many projects are on the website and stop why I have the right number of the projects. I have a lot of different features. It's not, there is not only one only way to stop a scraper, of course. In this case, for example, I run a scraper, let me to decrease the number from 10 to 5. I try to run the scraper on the first 5 page. So as you can see, I can also run a click on the sidebot cookie bot. This element identified by a unique ID is the banner. So with the selenium, we can click also element on the page. And I try to run my scraper and download the 12 page, the 12 project. And then I click to the show more. So as you can see, with Selenium, we can try to click on this object and I have the result. Okay, so my goal is to try to emulate the user. So to go down, click scraper and scraper to add project. Go down, click and so on. So with this 10 line of code, I can run, click the cookie button if present. Then try to check the first page, download, and so on. So, wait. Usually I put this time.sleep because I want to be polite. I don't want to make, to put in difficulty the IndiegoGo website with my scraper, of course. So I use this time.sleep to, of course, to be more polite with the web server, and of course, to better emulate the end users. So as you can see, I put this 3 seconds of wait between click and the next page. As you can see, as the result, we have 51 project, and for each project, we have all the titles. Now, we can use Pandas, for example, to visualize the dataset. We have the URL, the title, all the data, and to download the final data. So we have built our dataset. In the notebook, you will find a lot of our possibility to download our field. So please joke with the notebook, it's not a problem. Let me to conclude my interactive session. Because before start, we have to keep in mind that we can also use the API shared by the stakeholder. So keep in mind that in the browser, we have the element part, but also the network part. So let me to show you. If I clean with the clear button, and if I click the show more, in the GoGo, under the fetch slash is HR section, show me that there is this discover call. If I try to watch this discover call, I am lucky because in the preview, I can see a JSON file with 12 objects, as you can see, from 0 to 11. So I can, for example, copy the JSON. I go to a JSON viewer online. Okay, I'm using the first one. Okay. So as you can see, if I run a request to this page, I have 12 projects. For each project, I have the category, the open date, the description, the title, the project ID of IndiegoGo, the image URL, the founder raised amount, the founder raised percentage, the currency, a lot of nice features. So in this case, I think it's better. Let me to go down on my notebook at the end to use, for example, this request to run the scraper because it's more faster. For example, as you can see, with only the request library, with the request I can run, for example, a post, I can't find the parameter here because if I go to the headers, I can see the request payload to use. I can use this request.post to try to emulate this behavior. So let me to run only for the first 25. So in 20 seconds, I can scrape. Let me to see. ...24,000 project with a lot of details. So remember, before start to write code, please investigate, inspect in the better way the website. Try to inform the website because only 1 minute and I finish, I stop my interaction. Because there are a lot of questions about scraping and crawling data from the web. A lot of sentences, regularization, alert by the website. Of course, we have to be polite because remember to repeat yourself the question, can I scrape this data? Of course, the first step is to understand if the stakeholder wants that you scrape the data. How to check? You can go to a website, for example, you can check the robots.txt. The robots.txt is usually used by the crawler to check if the Google bot and so on can crawl the data. As you can see, IndiegoGo is quite polite. You can navigate every page of the site, not the account page, the API, and the project, and so on. So, first of all, try to check if the site allowed us to download the data. For example, if I go to the LinkedIn robots, it's completely different. I have a lot of denied. So, I have also a notice. So, please check. Second, try to inform the stakeholder, because in my experience, a lot of time, I don't know, the stakeholder doesn't have issue that if you scrape the data. I want only to be informed about your activities, what you do with the data, what is your program, what is your challenge, what is your purpose. So please check everything, the robots, try to engage the stakeholder, try to keep a look to the time of sleep, to the rate limits, and so on. Of course, because scraping activity is not simple. With IndiegoGo, it's very simple, but it requires, could be required a lot of time. So before start, try to discover if the scraper is only the possibility, or there are other possibility. Try to engage the web server. I don't know. I think you have the idea. So I am finished my time, I think. That's right, Raquel?
Yes, that's okay. Correct.
I don't know if there are questions.
I think Lillian said that she would run the Jupyter Notebook from the Google Collab. I think that, yeah, and Jesper already said that that's good. So I think that is
yes. Resolved. So I run a suggestion to you guys. My notebook is very simple, but you can reuse my notebook every time. I have a lot of students in my university that are coming from economics degree and marketing studies and so on, that use my notebook to create some nice scraper. Of course, Google Colab and my notebook are useful to create some one-shot scraper. But if your scope is to, for example, investigate a price, investigate an online reputation, it is good. So you can only adjust my notebook to your case and reuse it every time. Raquel, on Matrix, we have some question.
No, I don't see any questions. So if anybody still has questions, feel free to ask just now.
Okay, thank you, Hugo.
I'll post all of the links we shared here as well. Yeah.
Yes. In the link in my presentation, of course, in my repo, you find also my mail, my LinkedIn profile. Feel free to write me if you have issue with the notebook or if you want to have more information about my work and the ingestion, and also the other part of the work, because the ingestion is the first part. Sometimes I think it is the more nice part, because you see the result of your work. Of course, it's not only the only part of the data science system. It's the first part. Thank you, Yash.
Yes, I think what Yash said really quite chimes in with what I feel as well. Like, I've seen quite a few of these web scraping tutorials. I think this has been one of the best I have seen. Very clear. And thank you so much. Yeah. If anybody has any other questions, feel free to still ask on Matrix. And if you feel like you want to have another session with Mauro, if Mauro has the time, we could also book you into another session into the City Walks. That's the open space. So that's not recorded. That's you can just hang out with Mauro and ask any questions over there. That would be in the Conference 6 City Walks open space. Yeah, I can post it there as well. You can join the Jitsi and then have another video chat. Or alternatively, you could also go to WonderMe's lounging area and then just hang out.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Mauro. So now I guess we can sign off and have a break and then ready for the next session soon.
Okay, thank you guys, and thank you, Raquel, for your assistance.
Thank you. Cheers. Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.